world. Before we start this video, I just want to say I'm having huge problems with my Filmora 9 program. The latest update, which it likes to update every 5 minutes, seems to have installed some kind of problem in which I can no longer work with video or audio together at the same time or the entire thing will crash. Usually it crashes while I'm searching for different audio logs. This trouble has caused me to accidentally lose some of my data, specifically the video of me building this staircase that I'm running on now. So it will not be featured in this video. It's as if it doesn't exist and just popped up overnight. This frustrates me because it took me a long time to build the staircase, and I don't know. My video feels incomplete without it, but that's okay. I'm going to move on and we'll still have the video, and I think we can even still have the music if I can finagle the program to not shut down on me the second I add it. For now, I'm going to take out my frustration on this zombie piglet. Today's episode begins with me adventuring with the fuzziest of wuzzies, and although nothing important happens during this adventure that is relevant to our build, I did do one achievement that I just had to share.
And then it's suddenly 8 hours later, which is why I constantly check the time when I'm doing something I love.
Return the sender.
Yay.
You got return the sender.
On to the project. This bone meal farm here produces bone meal at a far superior rate than the last farm did. Although individually the cactus blocks grow much slower, there's more of them on a much wider area, and of course they do it automatically no matter what I'm doing. I don't have to go over and babysit it. So I'm ending up with a lot more bone meal, and that means that my projects can now be mushroom heavy. I'm going to start this project by growing a lot of mushrooms, and then I'm going to try to find a silk touch item to cut them all down with. I believe an axe works the best. Once I have plenty of mushrooms, I'm going to decorate my island to look like a real mushroom biome. I don't know what I'm going to do yet. This is mostly going to be an experimental phase, and this will be something I have to do over the course of many project videos, but hopefully I'll be making a huge step to making this island look like something you'd really want to visit. Next, I'll be getting some XP, not gunpowder. I have plenty of gunpowder in the barrel below. There's no need to kill these creepers by hand, but a quick whack will give me XP every time they die. And hopefully I'll be able to build up enough to where I can have a silk touch item. Constantly enchanting has really drained me of my XP, so it's good to have a farm that can produce it. Eventually the creeper farm clogged up with spiders, and I didn't want to wait on it to develop more creepers or for the spiders to despawn, so I just left and went over to the nether. These piglins spawn at an incredible rate, and there's always millions of them. Some overworld zombies decided to join the party. This fact I find odd because I haven't handed out any spawners yet. These zombies are just vanilla, natural spawning zombies somehow appearing in the nether, and I have no idea how it's possible. If anyone has an explanation, I'd love to hear it. Before we move on from the nether, I would like to push forward an idea about rotten flesh. Because I have a ton of it in this zombie piglin farm. It's getting ridiculous. Rotten flesh needs some kind of purpose beyond just eating it and getting sick. I think if it's sitting on the ground open as an item, a zombie or a zombie piglin or any undead should pick it up, other than skeletons, and munch on it to regain health, if they are low on health. That way, when zombies die, it makes other zombies around them tankier as they already pick up rotten flesh as they walk over it. Also, it would help if it had some kind of purpose, perhaps chumming the water, or using it as fertilizer, or something, because I have a ton of it, and I feel like the only thing I can do with it is just throw it in the lava. I make an iron axe with silk touch and begin harvesting mushrooms. The reason I made an iron axe and didn't enchant my diamond one I already have is because I don't know if I can repair the diamond one, but I do know I can repair the iron one. It takes me some time to figure it out, but eventually I start putting down the mushroom stem. I don't know the exact scale that I'm going to build this building, but I do know I want it to be big and easily seen from far away. I work late into the night placing stem blocks. I will need to place a lot of them, so I will need to grow a lot of mushrooms and harvest their stems. I've decided this one will be a large brown mushroom. The large red mushroom will have to wait until another day. Walking up the mushroom does seem to take a lot of time, so I've decided there's no need to put anything vital at the top. The top of the mushroom will be saved for simple decoration and a good vantage point. No need to put any production up here. It is now time for Timber's tips on working with mushroom blocks. Mushroom blocks break really quickly to an axe, so if you're placing them up high, you're in danger of spleefing yourself at any moment. They also have two textured modes. One is when they are first placed, and the other is when they're placed adjacent next to each other, and then one is broken. If you break one of these mushroom blocks, you will notice that the texture changes to the inside of a mushroom, a much lighter texture. This means that if you want that lighter texture, you'll have to place an additional mushroom block of the same kind, and then break it with your axe while not breaking the next block. This entire process is tedious, and I've made many mistakes while doing it. I've also been stockpiling a lot of carrots and other food items. Eventually I'm going to shut down all this production and move it to somewhere more private so that people can't mooch off of me. That includes my buddies and anyone else I decide to add to this server. While I was placing dirt, some phantoms flew in from out of town and decided to give me some trouble, so I had to teach them a lesson. It's time to work on the underside of the mushroom. This means a lot of scaffolding. I intend on adding hanging roots to the underside of the mushroom as part of its spore throw-offy things. I don't really know what the underside of a mushroom looks like in large scale, and I don't feel like looking it up, but I think this should be good enough. It's time for another episode of Tips with Timber. Scaffolding is love. Scaffolding is life. You owe your life and soul, and all that there is, to scaffolding. Let us all praise scaffolding and hope for its continued existence. If there's one thing I don't like about the mushroom biome, it's how depressing the ecosystem is. There's just mushrooms and mushrooms, and that's pretty much it. Whilst that's charming for the first day, the second day leaves a lot to be desired as you get sick and tired of what you've already seen just being everywhere. So, I plan on adding my own kind of ecosystem. My plan is to add a kind of after its heyday forest, where all growth has started to slow down, and most of the foliage you see is dying off or already dead, which is what's prolific to mushrooms. So I plan on adding these large jungle wood trees and modifying them to be a kind of taken-over mushroom tree. My modifications involve removing all the leaves. I want this tree to have been long since dead and stop producing any foliage of any kind. It also involves removing the vines. I'd prefer mushrooms to be the parasitic flora here at the mushroom biome. I used an axe on my way down from the scaffolding to strip off some of the bark on my way, and I also placed mushroom blocks while up there. And the result is a taken-over tree. It's kind of somber. It feels like this tree was once alive and lush, and now it's dead, and I plan on doing the rest of these trees over here. I think it'll add a good look to this mushroom biome and make it feel like this used to be a very different place before the mushrooms take over. And it will be a very different place once more, once the mushrooms exhaust all of their food supply and it is once again given to the foliage of green. Before I end this video, I'd like to increase the size of the Darkyard Village, mostly with a library. I'm going to have multiple librarians, multiple lecterns, and I would like to get some enchanted books in here, hopefully a book of mending. I switched from using wooden doors to iron doors. Iron doors cannot be opened up by villagers, and that makes this perfect for trapping them and keeping them inside. I opened them up using a redstone signal, allowed the baby villagers to walk in, then I close it, and they are in their lifelong profession. I also have managed to get books of mending from one of the librarians. He's been the only one I've built up so far, so I'm not certain what the other ones give me exactly. Whether my armor is perfect or flawed, I'm going to apply mending to it from now on. The last thing I need is durability being lost for no reason. The books of mending are relatively cheap, and I produce a lot of emeralds, so there's no excuse not to. With all the trouble I've been having with my editing software, my recording software, and pretty much everything related to Filmore 9, I was expecting this episode to be a bit of a bust, but I got a library done, I installed some dead trees, I grew a giant mushroom, built a staircase all off-screen. I'm also covered head to toe in diamond mending armor, which regardless of its other enchantments, is pretty awesome. This is, of course, the part of the video where I ask you to help me wage war on the algorithmo. Pull the whistle, tug the chain, hit the subscribe, ring the bell, and do pretty much anything else that is required for YouTube to show you my videos. I appreciate your continued watching, and I'll see you in the next video. For now, I'll be saying, bye-bye! Thank you.